வணக்கம் மேடம்.
குட் மார்னிங் சார்.
குட் மார்னிங். குட் மார்னிங் ஸ்டார்ட் மேடம்.
குட் மார்னிங்.
அதர்ஸ் வில் ஜாயின்.
ஓகே. குட் மார்னிங் ஆல்.
Yes.
It gives me an immense pleasure to welcome you all to the 10th Celebrities and Celebration Lecture on Ivaraste Galva by Professor R. Vittal Rao, a former Professor of Mathematics, Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. Sir, based on the feedback of last week from my colleague friends, sir, is it possible, Jammudagini sir, I request you to say some few words about bites, and also I kindly request you to introduce our chief guest, Vittal Rao sir.
Jamadagni sir is not around. Probably I'll do that.
Sir, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, so as the bytes is concerned, it's bytes stand for Board for IT Education Standards. It started in the year 2000 to improve the employability of IT graduates in the state of Karnataka. And we are completing about 20 years of service, and mostly we have institutions, academic institutions as members, and also a few corporates. The idea is to have an industry academia relationship, ensure that the curriculum is meeting the standards of the industry. Thereby, we conduct lots of programs to ensure that the latest trends of in technology, science, engineering to be brought to the students of the member institutions. I'm extremely happy that we are able to conduct activities, both annual activities as well as the CSE lectures, there are several others. And we are conducting programs on an average of one per week, more or less. That's the kind of thing that we have done in the recent past. And Professor Vittal Rao has kindly agreed to deliver the CSE lectures and distinguished guest lectures for BITES. And he needs no introduction because he's one of the best applied mathematicians in the country, and possibly most of us are fortunate to sit through his classes and learn from his expertise. Without much delay, I would request Vittal Rao to take over and tell us about the celebrity whom we have selected today. It happens to be his birthday, I'm sure about that. I request for Professor Vittal Rao to take over.
Thank you very much. First of all, I must warn that, as you all know, in the CSE lectures, it's more a general lecture than a very technical lecture. This will not be a technical lecture. Therefore, I would just generally look at the life of Galva, or the various events that took place in his life, and the mathematics that led to his contribution and so on. And most of it will be at a general level. So do not expect that Galva theory will be taught in this lecture. I think it will be totally impossible for anyone to try in a lecture like this, nor I am the right person to do it. There are good algebraists to do this. Okay, with this, let me begin. Ivaraste Galva was born on 25th October. So 3 days, a little late for us to celebrate his birthday. Anyway, I have chosen the title Ivaraste Galva, Revolutionaire Geometre. This was the title of a book written in 1956 by André Dalmas. The title was Revolutionaire Geometre, Ivaraste Galva. And the same words were used by a postage stamp issued by the French government. And you will see at the left bottom corner a portrait of Everest Galva, and at the bottom, the same words, evolutionary geometer, has been written. It means revolutionary, and for some reason, mathematicians were always referred to as geometer in those days. Perhaps I would prefer to call him a geometer revolutionary or mathematician revolutionary. That is a revolutionary mathematician, because he brought some real revolutions in mathematics in addition to his participation in the Republican activities in the French Revolution. I will divide the lecture into three parts. In the first part, I will review very quickly the history of the theory of equations that culminated eventually in the theorem of Galois. In the second part, I would briefly review a bit of his biography. And the third part will be certain events in his life, which had a tremendous effect in his life itself. Also, his struggle to get his memoirs and work recognized by the academy and the mathematicians of those times. There is a lot of lesson that one can learn from his life. There are lessons that students can learn. There are lessons that researchers can learn. There are lessons that professors, teachers, academicians, academies, administrators, everybody can learn by the events that took place in his life. So without much ado, let me begin with my talk. I may take approximately about 50 minutes. So let me begin with the theory of equations. The linear equations are the easiest to solve. I will not spend much time with that. The next important thing was the quadratic equation. Of course, everybody knows the solution of the quadratic equation. You wake them up in the middle of a deep sleep and ask them the formula for the roots. They will just blurt it out as minus b plus or minus root b squared minus 4ac by 2a. And the moment you change the positions of b, a, and c and ask them the roots, there'll be a lot of struggle. People will start hesitating, take a step backwards, and so on. This formula is so deeply rooted in our minds. What we will do is, we will, for the sake of standardization, we will take the coefficient of the leading term x squared as 1. That is, we'll take a as 1. So that will be the standard formulation, because we can divide throughout by a and make the coefficient of x squared as 1. Okay, so it always will write the equations in this form, x polynomial equation with the leading coefficient as 1. In other words, what is known as a monic polynomial. Okay, now about the quadratic equations, the Babylonians in 400 BCE and Euclid around 300 BCE, they had some idea of quadratic equation, but more from a geometric point of view, because they were always calculating some length, which happened to be essentially in the language of algebra, the solution of a quadratic equation. And therefore, since they were finding only length, their solutions were always positive solutions. They had no idea about negative numbers. The real progress was by Brahmagupta, who actually gave the formula for the quadratic equation, essentially in the modern language, is what I had stated in the beginning. He had clear idea about negative numbers. He even used abbreviation for the unknowns, usually the initial letters of the colors. From then on, developments or whatever, algebra, the name came from the Arabs. So, but they did not appear to have known about the advances made by Brahmagupta. Certainly, they did not know about negative numbers. For example, for Al-Khwarizmi, these three equations will be quite different. All of them are quadratic equations, but he wouldn't write x squared plus 15x minus 39 equal to 0, because that negative numbers were simply not there. So all the coefficients should be positive in the equation the way they write. So they did not have ideas about negative numbers. Then from the Arabs, slowly the situation moves to Europe. It was taken to Europe by Abraham Hale, and he wrote a book first in Hebrew, Later, it was translated in Latin, Liberum Brodum. And in this, this is the first book on this subject that was published in Europe. And he gave a complete treatment of the quadratic equations. Now, subsequent to Abraham's introduction of quadratic equation in Europe, say after 1145, right up to 1500, there was no progress. In the first half of the second millennium, there was no progress. The only thing that people did was try to master whatever has been done before. But the action started in the second half of the second millennium, particularly in the 16th century at the beginning, 1511, around that time, progress in cubic and quartic equations took place. The cubic equation, we have x cubed plus ax squared plus bx plus c equal to 0. Notice that I have taken the coefficient of the highest power x cubed as 1. That is our standard format. Now, the three mathematicians, basically there were mainly three mathematicians involved in the solution of this cubic equation, Del Ferro and Tartaglia and Cardano. And the solution they tried as follows. First, they looked at a special type. This is very important, this idea, that they looked at the equation without the square term. That is, it included only cube term and first power and the constant term. And the solution of this equation, the roots were obtained in this form. The trick was the following. Notice that the solution involves the four fundamental arithmetic operation: addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and extraction of the kth roots. That is why it is called radicals. Okay, and the solution involves the coefficients. So we write the solution in terms of the coefficients involving these basic five operations. The trick was to split the unknown x into two parts. And now when you substitute in the equation, we'll get only one equation involving u and v. So we have freedom to choose u and v, one more equation. So the choice is made in such a way that equation reduces to a quadratic equation in u cubed. So if I call u cubed as z, then the equation reduces to a quadratic equation. So we can solve for z, and so u cubed will be z, and therefore u will be z to the power of 1/3. So now maybe I should point out here, if you look at what is inside, these two are the roots of the quadratic equation, and they are u cubed and v cubed. So to get u and v, we have to take the cube root. So that is how the solution was obtained, okay? So we have the what is inside the root sign is the two roots of the quadratic equation. And then since they are u cubed and v cubed, we take the square root, the cube root of them, and we get the solution. There is a slight technical issue there, but we will gloss over that. That's the general idea. Then they looked at the general cubic and use the standard mathematical trick. If you know how to solve one problem, you try to reduce another problem to the known problem. We know how to solve a cubic equation without the square term. So if we have a cubic equation with the square term, you make a substitution and reduce it to a cubic equation without the square term. And therefore, we can apply the previous method and get the solution. So that's Cardano with the help of Tartaglia. There is a lot of history behind this fight between Tartaglia and Cardano on the priority and so on and so forth. But anyway, finally, the general cubic was handled by Cardano, and subsequently his student looked at the quartic equation, the fourth degree equation, and his student Ferrari solved it 5 years later in 1540. Then all these were summarized by Cardano in his, Ferrari's trick was the cubic was reduced quadratic, so the quartics will be reduced to cubic and so on. So they reduced to an auxiliary cubic equation. All these were summarized by Cardano in 1545 in his famous book, Ars Magna. So what the Italians did was something, this all happened in Italy, was something special in the sense that up until that time, right through the so-called Middle Ages, The aim of any mathematician or any scientist or whatever you want was to master all the work that has been done by the ancients. But here for the first time, the Italians started doing something new. They started solving equations which had never been solved. Cubics and quartics were never considered. So this triggered a chain reaction. Then people started saying, what about the quintic equation, the fifth degree equation? We want to solve them again by the radicals. That means we must use the solution, find the solution involving the arithmetic operations plus, minus, into, division, and the extraction of roots. And the trick adopted was to reduce it to a lower degree, because Tartaglia and Cardano reduced cubic to quadratic, Ferrari reduced quartic to cubic, so it should be possible to reduce fifth degree to fourth degree. That's the idea that they tried. And in fact, one of the German mathematicians even claimed that he had method for such a reduction. But it turned out that when he tried it for fifth degree, instead of coming down to the trick, instead of coming down to fourth degree, it went up to the sixth degree. So there was problem again. So the fifth degree equation remained an enigma. People really didn't know how to handle it. So the main question was, after the 1545 book of Cardano, as you can see, right, for another 100 to 120 years, there was nothing happening. There is no progress as regards the quintic equation. One and a quarter century has passed. Then the people started looking at the question. Okay, we want to express the solution, the roots, in terms of the coefficients. So there must be, must therefore carefully look at all possible relationship between the roots and the coefficients. So in this, this neat work was done by Wyeth first and then generalized properly by Girard. They looked at some fundamental relationship between the roots and the coefficients. For example, suppose I have a quadratic equation and I look at these two roots, then R1 and R2 are the two roots, then the sum of the roots is minus A1. And the product of the roots is A2. This everybody knows. Of course, you probably, everybody knows it in terms of AX squared plus BX plus C equal to zero, minus B by A, the sum of the roots. B in this case is A1 and A is one, so it is minus A1 and so on. So the sum of the roots is minus A1 and the product of the roots is A2. But if we now take a cubic equation and take three roots, then the sum of the roots is minus A1, sum of the product of the roots taken two at a time is A2, the second one. Then the sum, the product of the root, that is the roots taken three at a time, it is minus A3. So this is again a standard. Now this can be generalized. In general, if you have an nth degree equation, and if there are n roots, and if I denote by sk, the sum of the product of the roots taken k at a time. So I take the product one at a time, that means the sum of the roots, product of roots taken two at a time, three at a time, four at a time, five at a time, and so on. So if I take k at a time, I call it sk. And then the formula was simply s1 is minus 1 to the power of a1, minus s2 is minus 1 squared, a2, and so on. So the coefficients and the roots were related by means of these s1, s2, sn. Notice that if I, in this relationship, if I interchange the positions of the roots, if I call R1 as R2 and R3 as R4 and R2 as R3 and so on, so we rearrange the roots by different indices, the relationship does not change. The sum is still the sum, the product is two at a time is still the same, and so on and so forth. So these are, they do not change if we permute the roots. Okay, so the, this is a very important property. If you take any polynomial, note that these SKs are all polynomials in R, the n variables R1, R2, Rn. They involve only sum and product. Therefore, they are all polynomials in the n variables R1, R2, Rn. And any polynomial which is does not change under the permutations is called a symmetric polynomial. And these particular polynomials, Sk, R1, R2, are called elementary symmetric polynomials. These play a very important role in the theory of equations. The fundamental theorem is that these elementary polynomials are very important in the sense that any other symmetric polynomial can be written as a polynomial expression in the symmetric polynomials. Now, with all this in the background, Lagrange now enters into the picture and makes a solid contribution in the direction of the quintic equation analysis. He wrote a very big treatise called Reflections on the Solutions of the Algebraic Equations. He critically examined all the things that existed up to then, and he observed that the methods used by the previous fellows will not work for the fifth degree equation. He introduced certain notions called some auxiliary equations and ideas called Lagrange resolvents, which have a close connection with the problem of solution of the radicals. Lagrange's method were very orderly and neat and very systematic. Lagrange observed that the permutations, which was observed in the idea of symmetry polynomials, are the true philosophy of the whole question. He realized that these have a very important role in resolving this quintic equation question. Lagrange made a prediction, though this problem has not been, we have not found a formula for equations of higher degree, that does not mean that we cannot find. We have failed, that's all. So he still believed that there must be a formula which we have to work hard to find out. And he said that the previous methods are not going to work. And he did a lot of work in this direction. And still the fifth degree equation remained unanswered. He observed that this problem of the fifth degree equation is a challenge to the human mind. The final remark of Lagrange was that, well, we have done enough and we have developed the fundamental ideas and the theory, which appears to be new and general. And we would come back to this at a later time. But as history would have it, Lagrange never returned to the problem of the quintic again. Then, observing about the total failure for more than two centuries on this problem, a historian wrote that in a very military language, the ramparts are raised all around, but enclosed in the last door, the problem defends itself desperately. Who will be the fortunate genius? He knew that a genius is needed. Who will be the fortunate genius who will lead the assault upon it or force it to capitulate? The genius is yet to come. And that's our next step. So in the late 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century, there was some progress. Gauss wrote his thesis and he looked at the fundamental theorem of algebra. But the more important thing was he made a comment expressing skepticism about trying to solve nth degree equations by radicals. He said that it appears more and more likely that this resolution is impossible and contradictory. But then he added a very intriguing note. He said, perhaps it will not be so difficult to prove the impossibility for the fifth degree. He was not, he was absolutely wrong. It was not that easy at all to prove the impossibility of the fifth degree. After Gauss, the real, of course, again, just like Lagrange, Gauss never returned to this problem again. So the real progress started in the beginning of the 19th century with Paolo Ruffini, who for the first time claimed that the fifth degree equation cannot be solved by radicals. This was a big change in the thinking process. All these times, mathematicians felt, well, we have failed, but it doesn't mean we cannot solve. But this is the first time he's claiming that this cannot be solved. Okay. And he wrote a big treatise, Teoria Generale delle Equazioni, and it was a huge volume, two volumes of 500 plus pages. If one had to understand this proof, they had to wade through all these pages in the book. And whenever such things happen, the mathematicians are very skeptical and suspicious about it. Ruffini tried his best to somehow draw the attention of Lagrange to his work. He wrote three times to Lagrange. First, he sent the manuscript, the treatise. Lagrange didn't reply. Again, he sent to Lagrange with a note almost begging him to give his opinion. You see, I might have said something is new, but it is not new. I might have written a useless book, but please give me your opinion. And Lagrange again did not reply. Again, he tried a third time. Again, he sent it to him. Only you can, you have the right to make a comment on this and so on. But still, Lagrange did not reply. So three times, Ruffini tried to extract opinion from Lagrange, but Lagrange simply did not reply to Ruffini. But in private conversations, Lagrange seemed to have expressed some kind of appreciation of Ruffini's work, but still was not willing to accept the fact that the equations are not, the fifth degree equation is not solvable by radicals. Perhaps he didn't want to risk his reputation by endorsing Ruffini's work. Then Ruffini made other attempts to get it accepted. He wrote a paper. Then Delambre commented, Ruffini proposes to prove that it is impossible to solve. Then Ruffini was upset. He retorted, I not only proposed, but in reality, I have actually proved. Then Ruffini tried with the Royal Society. He sent his proof to the Royal Society, and Royal Society politely said, well, some of my members read, they found it satisfactory, but it's not our business to publish official approvals of proofs. I don't understand what it means. Then I will come back to Cauchy a little later, but in a letter that Cauchy wrote to Ruffini, which he received just a few months before Ruffini died, unfortunately, Cauchy really appreciated his work and he said it is worthy of attention of mathematicians. And he even claimed that Cauchy said that he gave a lecture on the same topic in the academy about Ruffini's work. But even Cauchy's appreciation, Ruffini's book became neither widely known nor accepted. More importantly, not accepted. Perhaps with the arguments were so convoluted, people found it difficult to understand. Yes, of course, subsequently, several years later, they found a gap in Ruffini's argument, but that could be fixed, but it would make the proof even longer. But what is important is to share that nobody at the time of Ruffini was able to locate the gap. But what Ruffini achieved was to direct the attention of people to looking at the possibility that, yes, maybe right, the fifth degree equation may not be able to solve by radicals. To cut the long story short, then whenever such problems in mathematics have come up, some young genius appears and then just sweeps out the solution in no time. Abel, the Norwegian mathematician, at the age of 22, finally resolved this unresolved question for several years that general quintic cannot be solved by radicals. He published an expanded proof in 1826, and one of his ideas would even settle Ruffini's proof also. So now the fact that the general quintic cannot be solved by radicals is referred to as the Abel-Ruffini theorem. As everybody involved in this quintic equation, and there was a lot of tragedy involved. Abel died very, very young. He was utter poverty. And finally, he got a job in Berlin. But before he could receive that letter, he died. As Ian Stewart remarked, the quintic seems to have been something of a poison chalice. Everybody who tried it ended up with some kind of a tragedy or failure. Now, of course, some clarification about Abel's theorem. What Abel showed was the fifth degree equation, you cannot write a formula, the general fifth degree equation, you cannot write a formula involving the four basic arithmetic operation and extraction of roots, unlike quadratic, cubic, and quartic, where we could do that. He did not say you can't solve the fifth degree equation, use a computer or something like that. Even analytic or some kind of closed form expressions using advanced mathematics like elliptic functions. Subsequently, people showed that, Hermite showed that you can express the solutions in terms of elliptic functions. You go a little further than the basic operations. But at the same time, specific quintic equations could be solved. For example, I've written an example, x to the power of 5 minus 243 equal to 0. The root is the fifth root of 243, which involves only the root is fifth root of 243, which involves only the radicals. So no other operations are involved. So it is possible. What Abel said was the general quintic, you cannot write a formula. But what is important was that Abel found a fundamental shortcoming of basic algebra when it comes to taming the quintic equation. The basic operations of addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division, and the extraction of roots, they have reached their limit of usefulness when faced with the quintic. Now, it's exactly under such situation, when pushed to a wall, that whatever you have created has reached the limit of their applications. Mathematicians create new things. To create new things, we need a new genius, and that's what Galois comes in. So after Abel, there are questions that still remain, namely, well, as you said, Abel said that the general fifth degree equation cannot be solved, but there are some special equations that can be solved. What about the sixth degree? What about the seventh degree? So can you tell us which are all the equations that can be solved by radicals and which are all the equations that cannot be solved by radicals? And now comes our genius, the Galois. And very briefly in two lines, I'll just tell what Galois said. Galois introduced the notion of groups, which involved the groups of permutations, which Lagrange anticipated, the notions of subgroups, normal subgroups, several things, very, very interesting things he introduced, important things. And then with each equation, we associated a group, which he called the Galois group. So with each equation, we have a group that's called the Galois group. If that group has certain properties, then the equation is solvable by radicals. If that group did not have that property, that equation is not solvable by radicals. So what Galois said was that if the group G had certain property called solvability, then the equation is solvable by radicals. G is said to, what is meant by the group is solvable? I just assume that we know what is a group. What essentially it says is you can eventually trivialize the group. That is, the smallest group is the group containing the identity element. So if you do sufficient iterations, you can trivialize the group in the sense that we can find a sequence of group starting with the big group, G naught is G, starting with the big group, Galois group, and ending up with the trivial group, that is identity, containing only the identity element. And in between, there are number of small steps. We go on getting into smaller and smaller subgroups. And these are all normal. Each one is a normal subgroup, what is known as a normal subgroup, previous ones. And the ratios of the number of elements on the consecutive ones is a prime number. It's a very very poor way of explaining Galois thing, but this is the essence of the theorem. But for lack of time, I will not go beyond this. So what is important is Galois introduced the idea of the group, and he looked at it as the group of the symmetries of the relationship between the roots of the equations. And he showed that this the group of symmetries plays an important role in deciding whether the equation is solvable by radicals or not. Now, what is the significance of Galois' work? Well, of course, he solved the problem of how to solve equations by radicals. And he introduced the idea of Galois group, which is the group of symmetries which preserve all the algebraic relations between the roots. And the generalizations of these ideas to the idea of essentially studying symmetry was the important contribution that Galois' work led to. Symmetry pervades almost every field of mathematics. And for example, physicists look at many groups like Laurent's group, Poincaré group, the unitary group, the special unitary group, and so on and so forth. And groups become the language of symmetry. Today, groups are the language of symmetry. Galois took the vital step along the trail that formulated symmetry as the invariance under a group of transformations. Henri Poincaré once said, "The whole of mathematics, stripped down to its essentials, is just groups." And Ian Stevens said, "Yes, it is an exaggeration what Poincaré says, but an excusable one, but it is because it is almost true." Okay. So while introducing the notion of groups and the invariance ideas and the ideas of symmetry, Galois had not only laid the foundation of modern mathematics in general and modern algebra and geometry in particular, but also laid the mathematical foundations of modern theoretical physics. Oh, that will be the first part where mainly the theory of equations are reviewed. In the second part, I will now briefly go through a brief biography of very quickly. He was born on the 25th of October in a place called Bougerain in near Paris, and his parents were Nicholas and Adelaide. His father was elected as the mayor of that place in 1815, and in 1823 he joined Louis Le Grand College at the level of class 4. He does well and wins many prizes in the first year, but in 1826 he was asked to repeat because his work in rhetoric was not up to the standards. And in 1827, he is a turning point in a sense. He enrolled his first mathematics class with his teacher, Bernier. And he becomes involved in mathematics. And the report by the director of studies was, this guy is fully interested, passionate about mathematics. His parents should let him do only mathematics. Otherwise, he is wasting his time. He's creating problems for us, and is creating problems for himself also. And Vernier reported very nicely. I think these two teachers of his, one is Vernier and the other one will come shortly, were very clear, very correct in their observations. He observed that it is intelligent, marked progress, but not enough methods. It was a little haphazard. He was in a great hurry to say everything and write everything. And in 1828, like all the students these days write the IIT, JEE, he took the examination for admission to École Polytechnique. That was the dream of everybody in France at that time, to join the École Polytechnique. But he failed the entrance exam. Many of his friends were surprised. In fact, his failure itself was a big controversy. Even 25 years later, the editor of the journal New Annals of Nouvelle Annales of Mathematique, he wrote, "A candidate of superior intelligence is lost with an examiner of inferior intelligence." He quoted an old saying, which means, because they don't understand me, I am called a barbarian. So he writes, examinations are very mysterious, and like theology, we should not reason. We simply accept whatever they say and get over it. But for Galois, the failure in École Polytechnique test was almost hurt him deeply, and for almost for the rest of his life, he was embittered with the whole system because of this. And then his interest probably in École Polytechnique was twofold. One, because the academic opportunity that he had, so one of the best place in France at that time. And the other one was his parents were very strong Republicans. And he had also become a strong Republican and had political interest. So because of the political activities that were taking place in Polytechnic, he was interested in going there. But having failed in the entrance exam, is back in Louis Le Grand. Again, he enrolls for a mathematics class of Louis Richards, very nice person who helped him very nicely. He recognized the talent in Galois. Much better than probably the fellows in the academy. Then anyway, he studied Legendre's book and also Lagrange's book on the theory of equation. That is important. Lagrange, he understood Lagrange. And Louis Richards reported the student works only in the highest realms of mathematics. He understood him very nicely. On July 2nd, 1829, his father committed suicide. Apparently, there was a problem between the Jesuits and his father, and one of the priests forged his father's signature on some documents of disrepute. It was a conspiracy, and his father was forced to commit suicide because he couldn't tolerate this. A few weeks before his father's death, Galois writes again, the second time, admission test for Ecole Polytechnique, and again failed. So geniuses fail entrance tests. So if you have failed an entrance test, consider yourself a genius. And October 1829, he then, instead of failure to join Ecole Polytechnique, the next best choice available was the Ecole Préparatoire in France, which later became the Ecole Normale. It is now a very famous place also, Ecole Normale Supérieure. So on December 1829, he received his baccalaureate degree, and the examiner's report read, "This pupil is sometimes obscure in expressing his ideas." Again, they are very correct observation, because clarity was at a premium with Galois. But he is intelligent and shows a remarkable spirit of research, and a very accurate assessment of Galois in a sense. But an interesting report was the literature examiner's report. He wrote, "This is the only student who has answered me poorly. He knows absolutely nothing. I was told that this student has an extraordinary capacity for mathematics. This astonishes me greatly, for after his examination, I believed him to have but little intelligence." Very surprising, lousy report anyway. Then I think more or less that was the end of the academics of Galois. Then he gets involved in the revolution. King Charles runs away, flees the country, the riots in the streets of Paris. Then the director of the school, the Ecole Préparatoire, asked the students not to take part in the street riots and all. So he closes the gates of the college. But Galois tries to scale the wall but fails. Then the director writes in the newspapers very strongly against the students participating in these riots. Galois replies again strongly back to the director. Because of this letter, he was expelled from the college. So Galois is now out of complete academics he is not even 18. So all the work he did was during the period when he was 16, 17, 18, okay. So in July 1830, he joins fully into the revolution, artillery of the National Guard. This was abolished by the king by December. And then in July 1831, he was arrested for wearing the uniform of the artillery, and he's supposed to have taken a toll proposed a toast, which was interpreted as against the king and in threatening the king. And so he was arrested, and the trial was took place, and he was sentenced to 6 months prison. Then by March, there was an outbreak of cholera. And so he was released from the prison on parole and sent to a convalescent home. And that's again a turning point in some way, bad turning point. He's said to have fallen in love with Stephanie Motel, the daughter of the physician of the convalescent home. I don't know, after some short affair, she seems to have distanced herself from him. Then 29th of April, he was released from prison. He's back to his Republican fellows and activities. On the 30th of May, he dies in a mysterious duel, shot very badly in his stomach and several pierced through the stomach and shot in a mysterious way. There are lots of theories about the duel, the reasons for the duel and so on. But anyway, he died on 31st of May, 1832 in the Cochin Hospital at the age of 20. On 2nd June, the funeral was held. About this whole last few events of his episode, his falling in love with Stephanie, and then getting messed up with this duel and dying and etc. E.T. Bell says that in all the history of science, there is no complete example of the triumph of crass stupidity over untamable genius. Now, this is the last part of my lecture, the part three, the saga of his memoirs. Now, I'll quickly go through this. So, on the 1829 and the 25th of May, his teacher Richard encourages him to submit his work. And he, through Richard, through one of his friends in the academy, it was handed over to Cauchy. Cauchy does briefly introduce us to his academy. And the refereeing work was allotted to Fourier, Navier, and Poisson. Now, 18th January, 6 months later, Cauchy wrote to the academy that on that meeting of the 18th January was supposed to present, along with his own work, the work of Galois also. But since he was not well, he wanted to present it in the next meeting. The next meeting was after a week, and promptly Cauchy completely ignored Galois' work and presented only his own work. A few words about Cauchy. We have heard Cauchy two or three times. Cauchy appears to be not a very friendly figure. He rarely showed any interest in other people's work. He always used to talk about only his work. Okay. And there are only two occasions that he seems to have deviated from the fact that only his work is done. One occasion was he wrote to Ruffini that he presented Ruffini's work to the academy. The other one is when he briefly introduced Galois' work. And then subsequently, he completely forgot about that. Abel writes about Galois in a letter to his teacher. Very interesting to read. He says, Cauchy is mad. It's impossible to communicate with him. However, at the moment, he is a mathematician who knows how mathematics should be approached. His work is excellent, but it is difficult to read. At first, I understand practically nothing. I'm getting somewhere now. Cauchy is a Catholic bigot. It is very surprising in a mathematician. He's the only one dealing with pure mathematics here. All the others are doing mathematical physics. And then he said, I did something. I showed it to him. But Cauchy just had a glance at it, but never mentioned anything. But I think it is a very good book. So Abel also had his real problems with Cauchy. And Gauss also had, I'm sorry, Galois also had his problems with Cauchy. But these were the two geniuses who handled the fifth degree and higher degree equation. This was all written in a letter to his teacher, who was also a very good friend of him. In June 1829, the Academy announced the Grand Prix of Mathematics. And Galois, having waited for Cauchy's report on his work, got tired. So he added a few more things to his memoir and submitted his work for the Grand Prix. Okay, memoir solar, condition the solution of equations by radicals. The prize committee consisted of Lagrange, Lacroix, and Poisson. And the Fourier took the manuscript to his house for some reason. And within a few days, Fourier died and the manuscript was lost. So the manuscript that Galois had submitted for the Grand Prix was completely lost by the academy, and the prize was awarded to Abel. By that time, Abel had also died. So then Abel and Jacobi were the prize winner. Fourier was very furious. Then he wrote a strong letter to the academy, asking whether at least now will you be able to give me the opinion on my memoir, or have they also lost it. So he writes that maybe the committee decided this fellow is after all a student, what he might have done, and therefore he did not even bother to consider his memoir for the prize. And he goes on writing very strongly that I informed that memoir has been lost. This should have been a lesson for me. Again, I submitted it, but nothing has happened. Please let me know whether Lacroix and Poisson are going to give their opinion, or have they also lost my memoir. So he was very, very upset and started writing very strong letters. And actually, when Galois was arrested and Putin was his trial was there. One of his, I think his brothers authored this letter. They also wrote in the newspaper about the various problems that Galva had with the academy. And they say, despite all his efforts, he has met only with nothing but indifference and scorn for his talent. And this is what has made him very embittered. And you must understand the conditions that has led to all the events. But in response eventually to these newspaper articles, etc., on July 11th, 1831, just roughly about a year before Galois' death, the Academy announced Poisson Lacroix presented the verdict and the memoir was rejected. Galois' work was rejected. And the report said, it is badly written, we don't understand what's going on in this. Of course, they also justified a little bit in this. Anyway, I'll come back to this shortly. But in the state at which this part is submitted, we cannot recommend it to give your approval. So the Academy rejected it, and it had to wait some more time for acceptance. So when he was in prison, he was upset with all these things. He wrote a very strong, drafted a very strong preface to the memoir that he wanted to publish himself. And in that, he simply blasts the whole system. He says, well, I deliberately do not put any big surnames, no Christian names, no titles, no honors, no eulogy to some niggardly prince who will give you money when he is praised and will not give you money when he is praised. I have not thanked any high-ranking personality in science, and so on and so forth. He simply tears apart the entire system. And well, as one of the professors pointed out, the situation has still not changed. If you do not write a proper acknowledgement with all the big people, your paper may not be accepted, as he said. And he said, if you replace the word of a niggardly prince by funding agency, it still remains the same. He was very critical, very sarcastic when he said, for most researchers today, in between writing grand proposal, describing what he intends to do, and writing reports after that as to what he has done, he has very little time to actually do something. That's the position of research, in a way. He had very strong views about the system of teaching and education, etc., during that period. In a letter, it was published in the Gazette d'Akoul, he wrote several things, very strong views about recruitment of teachers. He goes on saying that, what difference does it make? What is the opinion of the teacher about religion or the politicians or the rulers? What is important for me is whether he's a good teacher or not. And he says, mediocrity is still rewarded. So the appointments are all questioned. And secondly, he says, how is mathematics taught? He starts with the way in which schools are teaching, and they're all preparing students to go to Ecole Polytechnique. He says, what is done to assist them? Is there any attempt to make them understand the true spirit of the subject? Any attempt to make reasoning as an important thing? For how long will these wretched youngsters be forced to do nothing but listen and repeat all day long? Then about examinations, he has a word or two, a mouthful. Why do examiners ask such confusing questions? They seem to be afraid of being understood by the candidates. What is the origin of this deplorable habit of compiling artificially difficult questions? I think some of the entrance exam people must think about this carefully. Okay. Thus, it would be right to say, this is about almost reflects the situation in coaching classes, trying to guess the eccentricities and temperament of individual examiners and trying to train them. If the question is worded like this, your most possible answer is zero or something like that. Okay. Then about publishing of the so-called guides and books, he says, what is the origin of this? We want the book to be very big. The more there is in the book, the more profit. And if it is to be written by the examiners, that is, then it becomes more. It is like the guide. Okay, he's talking about the guide. The guides contain nothing but some big theorem of a great master followed by some stupid schoolboy like essays by the author himself. then I come to one of the most important letters that Auguste, he wrote to his Chevalier on 29th May 1832. This is the day before the duel where he was shot, and he was going to die next morning. So the previous night, he summarizes all his words, writes a long letter to Auguste Chevalier, asking, actually appointing him as the executor of his academic work and asking him to publish, etc. And he writes many things. He says that I have done many things. All this will make about three memoirs. And then he goes on outlining what is today known as the Galois theory, and adds a few more theorems to the along to the original manuscript that he had submitted to the academy. Then he says, my dear August, these are not the only subjects I have explored. And then he says, I have no time, and my ideas are not sufficiently developed in this at this time. So then he writes the following. This is the original, and you can see that in the, let me see. In the top, you will see the names of Jacobi and Gauss. He has written something there. So let's see what is it that he has written about Jacobi and Gauss. So this is the French version. This is what the transcript of that. I will write down the translation. Some of you might have attended the lecture of Professor Jamadagni a few weeks back on Hamming's, the revisit to Hamming's lecture on you and your research. One of the points that he pointed out that Hamming made was, you must think how important is the problem that you are working in. If that problem is not important, why are you even working about? So Galois says in his letter to Auguste Chevalier, he writes there, to make a public request to Jacobi and Gauss, show them this, my manuscript, and ask them publicly. Now he says, what do you want to ask them? Not about whether this result is correct or not, whether this is important or not, as to the importance of this theorem. So he knew that this is a very important thing, and then you should really worry about the truth. Then he said, once that is done, I hope some men will find it profitable to decipher this mess. And this is a very famous note that he had put on the footnote margins, Je ne parle pas. He goes on and writes one of the last minute comments, and which has become most memorable and most sorrowful note, Je ne parle pas, is, I have no time. Very sad. He was dying in the next morning. He's writing everything in a great hurry. And so there it is, the last one. Je ne parle pas tem. That's here. Okay. Hermann Weyl. We saw that the literature teacher wrote a very bad report about Galois when he took his degree. But Hermann Weyl writes, this last letter that Galois wrote to his friend, if judged by the novelty and profundity of ideas it contains, is perhaps the most substantial piece of writing in the whole literature of mankind. Maybe the literature teacher would have turned in his grave when he came to know if he is told about this. Now, after Galois' death, you remember he had mentioned that you ask Gauss and Jacobi about the importance, then afterwards some men will find it profitable to decipher the mess. Then luckily there were, surprisingly, 11 years after Galois' death, Liouville showed some interest and then gave a lecture to the very academy which rejected Galois' memoir. He said that, I have found a solution as precise as it is profound of this beautiful problem. Whether there exists a solution by radicals. This is about Galois' manuscript. Then he goes on, he says that at the age of 16, as a student, he has done all these things. And then he also goes through the rejection by the academy, and he points out the reason may be Galois' way of writing, an exaggerated desire for conciseness was the cause of this defect. which one could strive above all else to avoid when treating the abstract and mysterious matters of pure algebra. Clarity is indeed all the more necessary when one essays to lead the reader farther from the beaten path and into wilder territory. So he accepts the fact that Gauss is now taking you away from the beaten path and into new wild territories. As Descartes said, when transcendental questions are under discussion, be transcendentally clear. And unfortunately, Galois too often neglected this advice. And thereby he justifies probably Poisson and others rejecting it. At the same time, he also makes what Poisson and others could have done is that, you see, they could have tried to advise him and then bring him back onto the right track. By the harshness of the other, to turn a beginner full of genius but inexperienced back on the right road. After all, this author was right there before them. He was active, he was very interested, he could have profited by their advice and the matters could have been sorted out. Instead, they simply rejected it. But then he says, let us not cry over spilled water, Galois is no more, things have changed, let us not waste time in useless criticisms, let us now look at what is positive and look at the work. And then he goes on to discuss Gauss' work. And then he says, I found this beautiful theorem that in order that an irreducible equation of prime order be solvable by radicals, it is necessary and sufficient that all the roots be rational functions of any term. Anyway, this lecture by Liouville finally brought into light the importance of contributions that Galois made. We must in some way be thankful to Liouville for bringing this out. And subsequently, Jacobi read Galois' paper, and as Galois expected, he understood the importance. And about 25 years after Galois' death, Galois theory began to be taught at the postgraduate level in both France and Germany. In 1909, a memorial was erected in the hometown. It was unveiled by the director of the École Normale Supérieure, École Normale, where he studied. And he said that, allow me to make an apology to the genius of Galois in the name of this school where he entered reluctantly, because Galois wanted to École Polytechnique, but he could get admission only École Normale. In the school where he was being misunderstood, the school which expelled him, for which school he was, after all, one of the brightest glories. And one may wonder how this idea of symmetry, the groups, etc., that Galois brought about in the theory of equation, no matter how ingenious, could now in the modern day evolve into a language describing all the symmetries in the world. After all, when you see some symmetry, it is not algebraic equations that come to our mind first, but still those were the ones. That is what Galois himself wrote, that it would be possible to understand fully the general thesis which I put forth only when someone who has an application for it reads my work carefully. And there lies the unity of mathematics and what the Nobel laureate Wigner called the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in the natural sciences, the way group theory entered in theoretical physics. And Baker calls it, what a wealth, what a grandeur of thought may spring from what a slight beginnings. And then finally, two more letters, very quickly. One was addressed to the Republicans, all his Republican friends. And he writes that, take any revenge against those who kill me. For those who kill me, forgive those who kill me, for they are of good part. These are reminiscent of the words in the cross, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And second letter is to Republican friends. In that he writes, I'm going to be killed in the duel. Sorry, I'm not informed you. Remember me, since fate did not give me a long enough life for my country to remember me. Now, Galois was wrong there. Fate might not have given him a long life, but not only his country, but the whole world remembers him even 200 years later. Now, finally, the last article. So firstly, a famous mathematician was asked to write an essay on both Abel and Galois during the centenary of Ecole Normale. And he wrote, "It is particularly characteristic of mathematics that two of the most profound discoveries of Abel and Galois were the work of two mathematicians, of whom Abel, one, was about 22 years old, the other was not even 20. So this is typical of mathematics, where certain major breakthroughs come from very, very young mathematicians. As Hardy says, mathematics is a young man's game. Now, I conclude with the famous saying, when we contemplate over the death of the great mathematicians like Ramanujan, Abel, Galois, all at such an young age, we are reminded of an aphorism, whom the gods love, die young. This was made popular in English by Lord Byron. It is an old saying, and the Byron's poem goes like this: whom the gods love, die young. And many deaths do they escape by this, the death of friends, and that which slays even more, the death of friendship, love, you, all that is. That is very relevant to Galois' this thing. And this is the original, Quam di diligon or the raison moritur, serum honesti. So we salute this young genius. I hope there are some young genius in the audience who get inspired by Galois, and we will see some breathtaking and path-breaking new mathematics coming out of these youngsters. And I hope the administrators, examiners, professors will all take a leaf out of all the criticisms that Galois has made about the very system itself, and take the good things from them, leave the bad things from them, and improve ourselves. Thank you very much. Before I say finally, I have very liberally taken material from three or four books, and particularly, and if anybody is interested, I can give the reference. Thank you. Yes, sir. I'm done.
Thank you, sir.
No, sir. Jamadagni here. Jamadagni here. Professor Murthy has to go somewhere else, and he's in some, I think, some other place. So he talk of one thing, and then about Galois himself. He's to be revered, and we use this every day. All our truth tables are...
I am not able to hear you properly. There is breaking.
Truth tables. So, this Galois is honored.
Hello?
Possibly because my internet is a little bit of a problem.
Okay,
That's the best I guess. We have a total paid there is a total power here on our side,
okay,
in the institute. So I'm unable to do anything other than have a slow bandwidth. I was just saying, Galois, all of our truth tables, minimization, all these kind of things are on GF2, the Galois
yes,
thing
yes.
too.
Yeah,
and so we sort of use him every day. And it's great to remember him and his impact, particularly digital electronics, and
unbelievable.
Actually representing state machines and so on. He's so profound, and what we call the kind of a concept used in redundancy checks and so on, they're all based on GF2 and higher
yeah.
orders of GF,
yeah, true,
Galois field. So it's 200 years after him, and a young man. And today we are really reaping the benefits of that. And the other small thing I heard, I don't know if it is true, this whole thing that he wrote about the Galois speech and so on, he happened to do it in the prison because he knew he was going to die.
Pardon
so
me?
He has a...
say that again.
Manuscript of a few pages, which actually came out of the prison finally after his death with the bull. And
no, I'm not able to understand you at all.
A lot of results that he wrote in the prison, I believe.
No, this is not really true. He, I think most of the things he had he finished by the age of 17, 18.
Yeah, yeah.
What he did in the prison was basically write a preface.
Yeah. That's what I meant. He wrote that whole thing, preface, about his work, condensing a lot of different kind of things in the prison.
Yeah. Hello?
Hello, sir.
Yeah. I see somebody raising the hand, Arul Alan.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sir, there is one. Sir, can you able to see the chat box, sir?
Chat there box. One, yes.
Okay.
No, there is one person, Arul Alan, who is raising the hand. Yes, in the chat box. What is there?
And there is also a remark from Ashok Rao.
So one question from Deshmukh, sir. Sir, amazing talk. What an inspiring life Galois was. Thank you for such a brilliant review of Galois' life. You mentioned Galois' work on group theory and also mentioned its importance in the context of symmetry and invariance. Does that him, instead of Emin Noether, the originator of the connections between symmetry and the conversation laws?
No, actually, Galois didn't have any idea about applying this to physics. Galois did only group theory in the context of theory of equations. It is the further work that was done later that was brought into physics and other things. So we must be very careful. Galois gave us the basic idea that there is an idea of symmetry which can, it is not just looking at it and seeing symmetry through the eyes. Through mathematics, you can see symmetry as invariance under the action of a group. This is what Galois taught us. That this is applied later to physics or anywhere else is not Galois' work. It is just carrying out further from Galois.
Sir, can you see?
You have something to say. Yeah.
Sir, Arul Alan, sir, sent a message in the chat box. Can you able to see or shall I?
Actually,
I think Galois chose the right GF to stay HD in history forever. The other who chose the girlfriend has gone unknown.
The other GF.
Other GF, yes.
Yeah, right.
But in fact, that GF, the Arulala, the Galois GF was responsible for his death. Yes. Yeah. Okay, there are lots of theories about the dual and his death, but which I will not go into.
Yes, sir, there are so many messages saying it's very interesting, excellent, and you took us to the life of Galois and all.
So I think you can conclude now.
Yes, certainly.
Madam Mahalakshmi, you can conclude.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I got a lot of messages. There are so many network issues today, maybe in Bangalore or I don't know. Okay, sir. So Galois, a French mathematician, determined a necessary and sufficient condition for a polynomial to be solved for radical. So this is a very short fact that we know about Galois. I thank Professor Vittal Rao, sir, who presented the life of the great mathematician Galois and his contribution towards Galois theory and the hurdles faced by him in a small span of his life. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. So we can conclude now.
Thank you, everyone.
Sir, okay.
Yeah,
Jamadagini, sir, you want to say something? Yeah, it's not audible. Shall I conclude?
No, sir? I mean, my network is really, yeah.
Okay.
It's better now.
So thank you one and all for joining with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.